In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. My younger son, Harry, had a somewhat checkered career in high school, academically and otherwise. But the one thing that he did there that he was really proud of, and he will be all his life, was making the varsity soccer team his senior year. He was never a starter, he only got into about half the games. But his school was and is known for having one of the best soccer programs in the Northeast, and it recruits from all over the place. So just making the team was a huge deal for him. Harry had done sports since the first grade, but the training regimen and the self-discipline required at this level was of a whole different order. I'm glad that he had this achievement to be proud of, but I'm much more glad because of what that experience taught him, which has stayed with him. That is the value of staying in good physical condition, how it makes your life better in all of its aspects, makes your work better, and how to maintain that condition through exercise and diet. He can literally feel the benefits and can feel the cost when he slacks off and doesn't keep it up, the cost to his work and to how he feels about himself. I'm glad he learned that when he does keep it up, he gets results. I think the single most important factor in what changed Harry's approach, what made him willing to buy into that self-discipline, was the coach. This was a young man, not a slave driver, he didn't yell. He motivated his players by quietly communicating to them the connection between their personal commitment to the work that was necessary and the result, a result which was not defined in terms of wins and losses. It was in knowing that they'd given their best. Well, you may already see where I'm going with this. The words of Jesus at the end of today's gospel are some of the most deeply comforting words in the whole Bible. Come to me, all you that are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. It's hard to imagine a human being that wouldn't resonate with. Which of us is not at some point in our lives weary? Even the most naturally joyful among us, which of us at some point never finds ourselves depleted, out of gas, no inner resources left on which to draw? And in these circumstances, the simplicity and the quiet assurance of Jesus' promise, come to me and I will give you rest, is like a drink of cool water to a parched throat. Jesus immediately follows this promise with a direction. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. This is the first step in our part of the process. It is in this way that Jesus gives rest. He repeats that same metaphor a verse later. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Some people might have an instinctive negative reaction to the image of a yoke, which seems to equate us with dumb animals and to ask for mindless submission to forced labor. But in Jesus' time, when most people literally earned their bread this way, the farmer and the animal worked together. Each needed the other, and the yoke was a tool to give direction and discipline, without which nothing could be accomplished. And you see here the connection with Harry and his soccer team. And in that case, the end result, which gave them all the deepest kind of satisfaction. Again, it didn't matter if they won or lost. Mostly. But that satisfaction, which they will never forget, they'll have it all their lives, they could achieve only by taking on the yoke presented to them by their coach. Now, on the surface, the three readings we heard today don't seem to have much to do with each other, but in fact, they all bear on this that I'm talking about. For some weeks now, we've been listening to passages from the middle section of Paul's letter to the Romans. These are chapters which deal with the law, the nature of sin, and what the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ has to do with all that. Now, you can spend a lifetime preaching sermons on just that. But just very briefly, for our purposes here, sin is the word we use to describe our inescapable tendency, all humans have it, to go wrong because of our insistence on putting ourselves rather than God first, insisting on our own judgment, our own determination of what's good and what's bad, rather than trying to listen and discern what God thinks about the world. This insistence is what we Christians call pride. That's the great sin that all the others flow from. And when Jesus talks about carrying heavy burdens, this is the biggest burden that we all must carry and do carry. As Paul puts it, we are captive to the law of sin that dwells within us, as we heard today. And it's why he ends this little passage with a shout of joy and relief. Who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The situation Jesus describes at the beginning of today's gospel is actually a good example of sin at work. His talk about children playing games in the marketplace can sound a little obscure at first, but we need to understand the context. He is talking about John the Baptist. John the Baptist has just sent him a message from jail, and that's what the conversation with the people is about. He compares people's reaction to John and their reaction to himself with children playing games. They play make-believe happy games, that is, weddings, and make-believe sad games, that is, funerals. And they criticize those who won't join in the mood of whatever game they happen to be playing at a particular time. The people associate John the Baptist with the sad games because John is a prophet and preaches with fire and brimstone. He preaches things people don't want to hear. They associate Jesus with the happy games because he likes to eat and drink with his friends. And they criticize each of them for not being the other. John's too sad. Jesus is too happy. What they're actually doing in this way is putting themselves in the center instead of God. And they are therefore blinded to the new thing that God is actually doing in each of them. They are especially blinded, tragically, to who Jesus is. And deaf to John the Baptist, who tells them he is unworthy to unlatch the thong of Jesus' sandals. This is sin at work. And in the reading from Genesis, we have something of an example of how take my yoke upon you and learn from me works out in practice. Abraham is settled in Canaan, the land God promised him, and he sends his most trusted servant back to his homeland to find a wife for his son Isaac. It's a long trip, and when the servant finally gets there, he does something smart. He sets up with his camels by the spring outside the town walls in the evening, a time when the women who were young and strong would be coming out there to draw water. So he'll get a vision of the whole field. And having done this, he then prays to God, saying, O Lord, God of my master Abraham, if now you will only make successful the way I am going. And then he prays that the woman he will ask to draw water for him will be the one God has chosen to be Isaac's wife. And that's what happens. But notice two things. First, after having made his own best preparation, settling the camels by the spring, the servant directs his attention to God in prayer, addressing God this way, O Lord, God of my master Abraham, not, O Lord, my God. He is choosing to appeal to the God of Abraham, who is not his God. He doesn't have a God. Because he has seen Abraham's faith and seen how that faith has been rewarded. Of course, this is centuries before Christ, but in this prayer, the servant is certainly beginning to take God's yoke upon him. Then he says to God, if now you will only make successful the way I am going. In other words, I've done what I can do. But in the faith of my master Abraham, I'm going to act in the belief that it's finally all up to you. And that's the way it works out. You see, he makes that choice. That's faith. That's taking on the yoke. And the second thing to notice is this. The servant is anonymous. We never learn his name. He could be anybody. And there's a teaching in that. We know that he's in charge of everything Abraham owns, so he's got to be smart and trustworthy. But in the matter of finishing the job he's been given to do, he is at square one. Utterly dependent on God. Like everyone else, like all of us. All the time. When Jesus says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me," he is simply inviting us to see the truth. That's why his yoke is easy and his burden is light. How easy, how light. We are rescued from this body of death. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.